Welcome to Night Prayer. The ancient service of Compline, or Night Prayer, derives its name from a word meaning completion. It is above all a service of quietness and reflection at the end of the day. The Lord Almighty grant us a quiet night and a perfect end. Amen. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, is prowling round like a roaring lion, seeking for someone to devour in the faith. Resist him, strong in the faith. Most merciful God, we confess to you, before the whole company of heaven, that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have failed to do. Forgive us our sins, heal us by your Spirit, and raise us to new life in Christ. Amen. The Old Testament reading. I call to God, and the Lord saves me. Evening, morning, and noon, I cry out in distress, and he hears my voice. He rescues me unharmed from the battle raged against me, even though many oppose me. God, who is enthroned from of old, who does not change, he will hear them and humble them, because they have no fear of God. Cast your cares on the Lord, and he will sustain you. He will never let the righteous be shaken. Here ends the lesson. The New Testament reading. See what large letters I use as I write to you with my own hand. Those who want to impress people by means of the flesh are trying to compel you to be circumcised. The only reason they do this is to avoid being persecuted for the cross of Christ. Not even those who are circumcised keep the law, yet they want you to be circumcised that they may boast about your circumcision in the flesh. May I never boast, except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, through which the world has been crucified to me, and I to the world. Neither circumcision nor uncircumcision means anything. What counts is the new creation. Peace and mercy to all who follow this rule, to the Israel of God. From now on, let no one cause me trouble, for I bear on my body the marks of Jesus. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit, brothers and sisters. Amen. There was once a rather enthusiastic historian called Richard Almack. While on a train journey, he would produce an ancient document and proceed to share his excitement with his fellow passengers. On one occasion, apparently, he produced a copy of the Magna Carta and proceeded to explain the freedoms that were established by it to his somewhat startled fellow travellers. Here in St. Paul's letter to the Galatians, he is addressing his fellow passengers, as it were, and asking them, and us, to consider the Magna Carta of Christian liberty. In this, he's not being strange or eccentric, quite the opposite, in fact, for rather than being off-centre, here he aims and hits the mark at the very centre of the Christian faith. His letter is a manifesto in which justification by faith and its resulting liberty are clearly identified as the freedom that has been won for us by Christ on the cross. Yet in his letter, St. Paul has a particular audience in mind, which is those who are willing to give up this priceless freedom in exchange for some reassuring rituals and over-regulated rule-keeping. The passage from Galatians that has just been read is towards the end of his letter. Here, in the last chapter and verse 11, St. Paul tells us that he has taken the pen from the hand of his secretary and is finishing the letter with his own distinctive, large handwriting. Perhaps, like me, he was short-sighted. But, in contrast to any imperfection in his eyesight, his spiritual sight is, by the grace of God, perfect. Here he summarizes two ways of thinking, two mindsets, if you will, that he has shown throughout his letter are in conflict. First, he offers a portrait in words of the kind of person who he could see took great pride in keeping laws and of boasting what good rule-keepers they were. Now, he doesn't criticise them for wanting to be good citizens, but he does question the motive of their heart. In other words, why do they keep the rules in the way that they do? Here, he shines a light not on their actions, but on their motives. What does it reveal? Well, that so often, our rule-keeping is not about wanting to please God, but rather that it comes from either a fear of what people will say, by way of criticism of us, or a love of human praise. Why does this matter? Surely God will be very pleased that we're law-abiding. Well, it does matter, because if my heart is governed by a fear of what people might say, or a hunger for being praised, then, St. Paul points out, I will not find myself walking in the way of Christ, who was crucified. Now, in every age and in every culture, there is no shortage of people who are willing to substitute morality and living by rules for a faith that trusts in God. St. Paul saw evidence of this even in the earliest churches, because most people, quite understandably, wanted to avoid opposition, or still worse, persecution, and to gain the praise of others. But in so doing, warns St. Paul, they will discover they have rejected the cross of Christ. Let's look at the alternative that he puts forward in verses 14 and 15. It's what St. Paul wanted for himself and for others. Far be it for me to glorify except in the cross of Christ Jesus our Lord, by which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. For neither circumcision counts for anything nor uncircumcision, but a new creation. There have always been those who want to make faith in God into a formal assent to particular truths. And this can seem very attractive, especially during anxious and challenging times like today, offering, as it seems, certainty in uncertain times, reassurance through rule-keeping, and a kind of hope through hauling ourselves up by our own efforts. Yet, in a time of great fear and real insecurity for Christian believers, the Apostle Paul wanted his readers to avoid doing just that. And so he ends his letter by modelling what a new creation, a new way of looking at things, a new mindset looks like in the daily life of a Christian. So he doesn't just affirm the truth that Christ died for sinners. Instead, he points out that those who truly believe would live lives that were unashamed of the cross of Christ. Far from being afraid of being associated with one who was crucified and therefore despised, in this new creation, the cross of Christ will be its pride and joy. St. Paul offers a double way of showing what it means to glory in the cross, in verse 14. By the cross, the world has been crucified to me, and I have been crucified to the world. These words echo what he wrote to the Philippians. I count everything as loss for the surprising worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. That's Philippians chapter 3, verse 8. But he says it in another way too. He says, I am crucified to the world. His old values, his old priorities, his old way of solving problems, of dealing with people, of coping with crises, no longer apply. Our liberty, we learn under this, his Magna Carta, his Great Charter, is not an excuse for ignoring the laws of our land or saying that no rules ever apply to me. Rather, that through the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, we are given the privilege of bearing, through the way we live, and through our dependence on the Holy Spirit, the fruits of the Spirit and Him crucified. For not just in Holy Week, and not just when we are once again able to meet in a church building, but now and always, Christ crucified is the basis of all our prayers, the assurance of all God's love, the certainty of full forgiveness, the ground of any future hope, and the source of our peace this very night, and, by God's grace, of morning mercies. Amen. The Song of Simeon. Now, Lord, you let your servant go in peace. Your word has been fulfilled. My own eyes have seen the salvation which you have prepared in the sight of every people, a light to reveal you to the nations and the glory of your people Israel. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. The Collect of Palm Sunday. Almighty and everlasting God, who in your tender love towards the human race sent your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ, to take upon him our flesh and to suffer death upon the cross, grant that we may follow the example of his patience and humility, and also be made partakers of his resurrection. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. The Evening Collect. Lighten our darkness, Lord, we pray, and in your great mercy defend us from all perils and dangers of this night, for the love of your only Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. A Compline Collect. Visit this place, O Lord, we pray, and drive far from it the snares of the enemy. May your holy angels dwell with us and guard us in peace, and may your blessing be always upon us. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord's Prayer. As you say this prayer, you will hear the Boyan Ensemble of Kiev, Ukraine, sing the Lord's Prayer in a setting written in the 7th century. In peace we will lie down and sleep. In peace we will lie down and sleep. For you alone, Lord, make us dwell in safety. Abide with us, Lord Jesus, for the night is at hand, and the day is now past. As the night watch looks for the morning, so do we look for you, O Christ.